How many times have you heard someone say, "Why do we have to be involved in politics?" I bet you've heard that one, haven't you? The answer is really quite simple. You see, we live in a democratic society, and democracy promises, even demands, participation. Since it is based on majority rule, democracy creates competition. Public policy is determined by hammering out legislation among groups and individuals who have the most to gain or lose. People with different views each advocate for their own point of view until a majority opinion emerges. It is this search for a majority view that makes its greatest demand on those of us who live in this democracy. The failure to participate in the decision-making process means that someone else's point of view can become law. Educator Robert Hutchins said, "The death of democracy is not likely to be an assassination from ambush. It will be a slow extinction from apathy, indifference, and undernourishment." Apathy and indifference are certainly enemies of democracy and education. Whenever a group of people or individuals does not participate, they lose, and democracy loses. All of us in ISEA must have a renewed commitment to making this process work by voting, working in the campaigns of endorsed candidates, contributing to PAC, and working toward making education and society better. As someone once said, those citizens who do not vote have no political influence. And those citizens who have the least amount of influence are those who only vote. That's what this program is all about, doing more than just voting. Here are a couple of scenes depicting interaction between a legislator and some ISEA members. After you've watched each situation, you will be asked to stop the tape and discuss what you've seen.
Well, I sent the note in about 15 minutes ago, so I don't know. There's so many people coming out.
How can you even tell who it is?
Well, I saw a newspaper picture of him. I don't know. He's sort of grayish.
Oh, I don't even know. Now, this is Smith, right? This is
yeah, Smith. Representative Smith. Right.
Pardon me, people. I have a note here from a Karen, a Con. I can't read the handwriting.
It's Convoy.
Convoy?
Yes.
Oh, yes. Well, what can I do to help you? Well, I assume you're here from up in Redfern County area, District 79?
Well, actually, not really.
No, we're not from there.
The ISEA asked us to speak to you about a bill coming up to increase school funding.
Well, you know, I've always been a great supporter of education here in the state, so I'm anxious to hear what you have for me. What can I do?
Well, that's great. The bill, well, we know things are tight monetarily, but
I should say they are.
But but you've in your campaign always said that you were a big supporter of education, so we'd really like your support in this bill.
Well, you need to speak to me in specifics now. What bill is it you're concerned about?
I did bring. Wait a minute, got it here somewhere. Wait a minute. Okay. The one that we were talking about was the HF 1501.
Right, that's the
and one. And it's going to do three things. First, it would provide an increase in funding to local schools of about 5.5%. And
yes,
secondly, it would give local school boards the right to levy taxes on their own motion since they are elected by local voters. And thirdly, it provides a minimum increase for school districts that have suffered through 0% increase because some school districts have been at that 0% increase for 3 years, it says here, but we just really need to count on you for this vote.
I've always been a great supporter of education, but let me tell you, there are two or three bills that are still in committee about education. If I'm not mistaken, 1501 is one of those, so you're really very early to be coming and talking to me about it. But let me go on to say, I am concerned about this issue of the tax levy that we're giving school districts the opportunity to raise taxes. I'm really concerned about that. My legislature colleagues have been telling me, and I'm hearing it from District 79, that to raise taxes in this difficult year with the flood that we've had is a very, very bad situation.
Well, sir, what we're interested in is this bill, though. Can we count on your support?
Yeah.
Well, you've got to help me out here a little bit. I just to willy-nilly ask for my support.
I just
what
just
are we going to do about
things.
Where we're going to find the money that we need?
Well, if you don't think you have enough money to raise the money for all the whole program, how about just raising the money to support these low-growth people that haven't gotten any money in the last 3 years? What about the thousands of kids in those districts?
Well, it seems to me that I do need to study this bill further, but let me tell you, it seems to me every year you people have your hand out for more money, and every year we've given you more money. Now, you've got to give me something back. You've got to help me out. Where are we going to find this kind of money?
What I think is that we need to look for someone who is going to be more supportive of education and run him against you in that next primary.
Well, I think I have a committee meeting I need to attend to. It's been lovely talking with you.
I better go.
Can you believe that?
Well, come in, folks. Hi, how are you? Jack Smith, good to see you.
Hi.
I understand you folks are in from up in Redford County.
Right. John Ryan,
good. John Ryan, good, good.
Maribeth, Milford.
Please have a seat. You're from Milford, huh?
Right.
Well, it's always great to have people come in from up in District 79. What kind of mission are you on? What can I help you with today?
Well, we had called earlier, made the appointment, and I hope you got the package that
we
sent.
I'm glad that you called and made that appointment. As a matter of fact, it gave me a chance to review House File 1501. I think that's one of the things you expressed an interest in talking about. And that's going to hopefully be out of committee soon, and then somewhere before too long, it will be on the floor, and we'll have a chance to debate it. So tell me how you feel about 1501. What kind of legislation do you think it is?
Well, we think it's a good piece of work,
yeah.
And the ISEA really would like your support. We feel it's important, and we feel it's a good bill.
Good. I always appreciate having you give us some input on that.
Well, as you know from reading the information we sent you, 1501 is going to do three really important things. And the first thing that I'm really excited about is that it's going to raise funding for the local school boards for up to 5.5%. And this is really important because our costs have gone up so much in the last couple of years, and boy, it's just really hard to keep up with it. And 5.5% is really going to help us a lot in getting those books and getting some new equipment.
Well, unfortunately, and you people have got to appreciate that this is a tough year for us here. The legislature is fighting a deficit situation. We've had this flood this summer that's really hit the budget. So I don't know whether we're going to be able to give you a 5-something% increase across the board.
We understand that this has been a tough year for everybody, but we had a media company do a survey for us, and it said that Iowans believe that education is the number one priority in this state, and if anything had to be cut, education would be the last thing to go. So we can provide that survey.
That's a survey that you've recently done?
Right, with Media Associates.
I appreciate getting a copy of that.
Oh, we can do that.
I'll make sure, I'll take a note of that and make sure that we can get you one in the mail, right.
See, part of the struggle we're having now with an element of 1501 is that it gives school districts the opportunity to raise taxes. And many of the folks up home are real concerned that we not raise their taxes.
Well, we feel that's real important, though, because a lot of times these school districts are in a 0% increase, and they haven't had any funding for the last 3 years.
Right.
And if the local school board can raise those taxes, then they have a chance to not affect the whole state, but just their local area on a short-term basis, and they can have better control over it.
You're telling me that some of the districts actually haven't had increases?
Right. Well, right now, we have a terrible problem with schools that have many different things. They've got a lot of extras, a lot of different athletic teams. They have carpeting throughout the school, vending machines, a very big school lunch program with many different options. Well, we have other schools that are basically meeting the basics, and we really need to have that addressed.
Well,
it's becoming a big concern.
You know, I have to admit to you that I'm more an expert in our county road systems and the road use tax business than I am in education. So I find that interesting. It seems to me every year we've given the schools an increase in money, but you're telling me some of these districts have not enjoyed that.
Sure, across the state, as the money is apportioned, some schools get more benefit than others do, and some of these schools have been left at the same level of funding for that length of time. We feel that if they're able to raise taxes on a local basis, they can fix their problems.
Exactly.
rather than addressing a big scale situation, they can raise the money and spend the money locally.
And your survey that you mentioned speaks to that point.
Mm-hmm. Yes,
that
it does.
Correct?
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I'd really like to get a copy of that. Now let me ask you a question. Okay. Where do we stand up in Redford County on this fiber optic cable business? Seems to me the state has poured an awful lot of money into that rat hole.
Well, actually, there is a lot of support for it. However, we're finding that the same schools that have a lot of the other benefits to begin with, they're the ones who are getting the fiber optics program and enjoying it the most.
Ah, right.
And the other schools who are lacking to begin with are, I don't know, just waiting for it to trickle down or something.
Yeah, and it seems to me that it helps these smaller schools that can't afford to have a German teacher, for example, although mm-hmm. the curriculum requires foreign languages.
That's the idea, to help those small schools, but it ends up that they're the last ones to receive it, just like the funding, and that's what we're working on this bill for.
It would help me if you people have developed some positions or you have some data on this issue mm-hmm. of this fiber optic network, because it's going to be a major debate in the House and I think probably in the Senate as well about whether or not the state is going to pour more money into that program.
Okay. Some of our people could work up a statement on that and also give you an idea how we'd like to see the fiber optics access distributed. We'd be glad to supply that to you.
Good element of it.
And we'll also go back and discuss some of the things that you brought up today, because I think that that would help us in developing another proposal, and we could put together another package.
I appreciate that. Yes, as you talk with the folks back home, let them know you came in and talked with Jack Smith.
Well, it's been a pleasure.
I'm always a good friend of education. Yeah. Lovely to have you in here.
We really appreciate your
seeing
us.
Give me a call again when you come down to Des Moines, and we'll get together.
Well, thanks so much.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Nice to see you.
Thank you.
Let me now introduce two legislative leaders, Representative Art Oley of Clinton and Representative Brent Segrist of Council Bluffs. We've asked them to discuss how teachers can be more effective in their dealings with legislators.
You know, Art, you've been in the legislature for 11 years and I've been in for 9 now, and we've both seen good and bad methods of contacting legislators. What do you consider to be the most effective method for somebody to contact a person in the legislature?
Well, I think the most important thing is that the contact be sincere, spontaneous, and well-informed. I think that the two biggest mistakes that people make in contacting legislators or in communicating with legislators is, on the one hand, they think it's too difficult and get all tense, or on the other hand, they think it's too easy and do it in kind of a slipshod, haphazard manner. The truth is you have to be right someplace in between that. Legislators are no different than anybody else. They're as easy or as difficult to talk to as anybody else. It's just important to make the move. But they need to remember, people have to remember, that it's good to do your homework before you do it.
You know, I think that's a key point, that they have to know what they're talking about. And one method I think that maybe enough teachers don't use is showing up at our meetings on the Saturdays during the session. That way you know what's coming up and what's going to be discussed, and you have the direct input, the face-to-face contact. I think that's one thing that perhaps teachers don't do enough of, and that's coming to those meetings, showing us as legislators that they're interested in what's going on, and talking to us after the meeting.
I think that's critical. I think you need to even go farther than that, or sooner than that. As people are running for office, teachers or any other citizen really ought to know basically something about the people that are seeking public office, and they should be supporting ones that are familiar with their views and supportive of their views in the first place. And once they're elected, then they will know that they have either elected a supporter or someone who is not as supportive. And they need to follow that up with regular contact, regular communication, both in times of crisis and when times are not critical, so that they have a regular line of communication.
And another thing I think that teachers need to remember is it's all right if Cluis Walden comes into my office to talk to me, or Angie Kane, or Jan Reinecke, or what have you, but it's the people back home that are most important. Those people can't vote for me necessarily, and if I have them come into my office, I certainly listen to them, they're very knowledgeable, but to have a teacher back home contact me, I think that's very, very effective, and at the same time, I think that it's necessary for us to know that they're involved back home.
That's a very common mistake. If you're going to visit with a legislator, the most effective visit you can make is with your own legislator, whether it's back home or whether it's in Des Moines. Now, there's nothing wrong with going to Des Moines and talking to a list of legislators, although people need to know that when they do that, they're on the verge of needing to register. Nevertheless, it's far more effective to talk to your legislator. If I get called out by someone who's not in my district, I think it's a far less good use of my time than if it's somebody that is in my district, for a couple of reasons. One, there's just the very practical reason of wanting to impress somebody from your own district, but you also know that those people know something about what's happening in your district and can provide specific information about what's happening in your district. And after all, every legislator represents a district. No matter how much we like to say we're taking the broad view and representing the state's interests as a whole, we do have to look out for the folks back home. And if the folks back home don't tell us what their interests are and what their needs are and what the problems are, it's difficult for us to address that. So you've got to start with that way, talking to your own legislator.
I think we would agree that a face-to-face contact is good. Phone calls are obviously very good, keeping in mind that it may take us a little time to get back to some people because we get a great deal of calls, and letter writing, certainly getting letters, individualized letters. To me, form letters don't have much impact, but if a teacher takes the time to write a letter to me, that means a great deal. But a form letter, I personally don't care for.
There are many different ways of communicating, as you well know, and I will agree with you that the most important, the most effective single communication is a spontaneous letter. I think teachers need to know that it doesn't have to be a big deal, but I think do have a right to expect a letter from a teacher to have certain characteristics about it. I think the word should be spelled right, and the paragraph should be somewhat according to standard grammatical form and things of that nature. It doesn't have to be typed, but I think there should be some thought given into both the form and the substance. But one individual letter that is obviously self-motivated and spontaneous and identifies a specific problem is effective than thousands of postcards that come in with signatures at the bottom of a printed form.
And I guess the last thing that I would really say is how important it is for them to be involved at the grassroots level. I think you would agree that we're near a crossroads in Iowa as we get our budget deficit under control, and we're going to be looking towards the future with a view on where we're going to spend the additional money we have been putting to deficit reduction. And I think that we need to have a grassroots movement by the teachers to let us as legislators know where that money should be spent and what the vision for education in Iowa should be. And I would encourage them to get as directly involved with their legislative people as they possibly can.
And I think that's all the more reason why teachers need to do their homework. I think they need to know what the situation is at home. I think they need to know what their district status is relative to the telecommunication network, for example. I think they need to know whether they're a zero growth district or not. There's very basic information, and that information is not all that difficult to find. If they don't find it locally, their organization has it very readily at hand, and they need to have that information familiarized before they come and talk to be fully effective.
What Art and I have tried to talk about today is what we consider to be effective lobbying techniques. We think that we're average, normal citizens like everybody else, and that you can approach us. We think it's extremely important that you be informed about what you want to talk to us about, because we need input to be effective legislators and to make good decisions.
Each of us must be an advocate for education and kids in the most effective way we can. We must be a role model for our students. We must demonstrate the importance of participating in this process that leads to every single decision that affects our students and our profession. This is the promise and the price of democracy.